It arrives as a rush hour surprise.
My car is now totaled!
Pummeling cars, shattering windshields, trapping drivers in a deafening deluge.
This sucks. Absolute crap.
I ran from my house to my car and had welts on me.
Baseball-sized hail, throwing a curveball to homeowners and auto dealers.
I mean, you look at the big one over there. I mean, this is like somebody came and just belted it with a golf club or something like that.
Damage so extensive, it forces one of the metro's biggest, busiest shopping malls to shut its doors for a whopping 6 months.
Then when the ceiling started collapsing, we ran out of the store, locked the store, ran out of the store. The whole entire mall is flooded inside.
It's official. May's devastating hailstorm is now the costliest catastrophe in Colorado history. Tonight, the science behind the storm. Why is our state a magnet for monster-sized hail? What's the best way to predict when we might get clobbered again? And we'll take you inside the Boulder Lab, where they study this weather phenomenon, collecting some of the biggest hailstones from all over the world. What they're learning about our billion-dollar storm.
Hello and thanks for joining us. I'm Jeremy Hubbard here at what has become the focal point of one of the most devastating storms in Colorado history. This is Colorado Mills Mall. The place finally reopened just days ago after being shut down for nearly 200 days after massive hail punched gaping holes through the ceiling and rains flooded the stores, causing millions in damage here. A crippling blow to retailers whose livelihoods depend on the very shoppers who are finally filing back into these stores. And all over neighborhoods on the west side of the metro, a similar tale. Construction crews still repairing the damage. Auto body shops still backlogged with all that hail repair. It raises the question, why does this happen here on this scale? Why does Colorado seem to be a magnet for these monster storms? Tonight, with the help of some of the foremost experts, we are literally dissecting this storm.
It was crazy. It was like a movie. I've never been in a thing like a storm like that.
By the time the storm came and went, it was raining inside from all the shattered skylights and busted windows.
From 2 feet away, you could scream and that person couldn't hear you.
For an entire week, the Larendon School in Denver was shut down after 90 skylights were smashed, the damage pushing $3 million.
Even several days later, we're still stunned by the magnitude of the storm.
Stunning is just about the best way to describe what happened all around Denver.
Our neighbor who's lived on the corner, original homeowner since the 50s, says it's the largest hail he's ever seen in this neighborhood in Denver.
That May 8th hailstorm is now the benchmark. It's our most expensive hailstorm in Colorado state history.
Carol Walker runs the Rocky Mountain Insurance Information Association.
Hail is our most expensive insured catastrophe.
She says a record 200,000 insurance claims were filed from the May 8th storm, and they are still tabulating the total bill.
To see a $1.4 billion hailstorm with one storm, it was during rush hour, so you had so many cars just sitting ducks out there on the roadway.
That easily moves it to the costliest catastrophe in state history. But before you can fully understand the cost, it helps to understand the cause.
In layman's terms, ice. Pea size, marble size, ice cubes, frozen liquid, frozen rain, it's ice. So when we were dealing with the storm May 8th, we were dealing with hailstones that went from 1.5 inches, golf ball size, to 2.75 inches. Now we're dealing with baseball size hail, and it's baseballs that are being thrown at 100 miles an hour. It's causing extreme damage.
But why us? Why here?
This one is producing hail. The radar is updating, and as I zoom in, we slice into that storm.
Our chief meteorologist, Dave Fraser, says we live in Hail Alley, and we are in the perfect spot for this kind of storm.
Anywhere east of the Rocky Mountains, from Alberta, Canada, to Albuquerque, New Mexico, including Denver and the Front Range, is considered Hail Alley. And it has to do with the relationship with the mountains. We get quick building thunderstorms during the heating of the day. And because we're up in altitude, the cold air is not that far off the ground. So you can make these hailstones very quickly and very efficiently over the Colorado landscape.
In fact, some of the most destructive storms, and sadly, one of the only deadly hailstorms, It happened right here in our state. In July 1979, a three-month-old baby in Fort Collins died of injuries from a large hailstone as his mother ran for cover, only the second person in recorded U.S. history to die as a direct result of hail.
This size hailstone is falling at more than 100 miles an hour when it contacts the earth or a person, and that'll kill you.
To learn even more about hail, we went to Boulder's National Center for Atmospheric Research and bundled up with the foremost expert on this weather phenomenon.
Clean this up a little.
Charles Knight took us inside the deep freezer.
Yeah, I've done this many times. I don't try not to get overconfident.
Where he actually dissects hailstones to learn more about them, how they form, and the storms that produce them.
You make a thin slice of a hailstone and polish it so that the surfaces don't diffuse the light.
Sliced thin under a magnifying glass, they look like magical kaleidoscopes. Hard to believe this is a hailstone. Look at them with the naked eye and you can learn even more about them. This is Charles holding a cross-section of one of the biggest documented hailstones that ever fell to Earth in Coffeyville, Kansas in 1970. It weighed 1.67 pounds. That's as much as a dozen Krispy Kreme donuts.
Like most hailstones, they're essentially solid ice.
Look closer at the rings, and much like a tree, they tell you how old the hailstone is, or how long it took to form and fall from the sky.
It weighed almost 2 pounds.
Case in point, this silicone cast of a behemoth, a nearly 2-pound hailstone that fell in South Dakota. It formed for more than an hour in the sky before crashing to the ground at more than 100 miles an hour.
I've never been in a severe hailstorm like that, no.
He has seen it all when it comes to hail. He studied hail for more than 50 years. But Maystorm?
I've never personally seen anything like that anywhere.
The question is, how do we know when and where the next billion-dollar hailstorm will hit in Colorado? Well, that's the tricky part.
We'll never forecast hail more than a half an hour or maybe an hour ahead of time, and that'll be dicey.
But it has gotten a lot better. Used to be when you would forecast thunderstorms, say 10 years ago, 15 years ago, any thunderstorm had the capability of producing hail, gusty wind, lightning, and of course tornadoes. Now we have algorithms built in where we can track the cold air aloft and we know when a thunderstorm has reached that limit, and it will actually show up on our radar display saying this thunderstorm is about to or is producing hail.
The rain in the top of that storm is encountering the very cold air.
Researching hail, learning as much as we can about it, can be critical, not just to homeowners and insurers or roofing companies, but farmers too. And scientists are making progress.
Developing nets that farmers with really valuable crops like grapes can use to cover the crops if there's a possibility of hail.
Any advance warning is good, but it's hard to do. And if it seems like hailstorms now are worse than they ever have been before, that's actually not the case.
We've heard of baseball-sized hail before. We know of large hailstorms in the past. It's basically Denver has grown. And if you think about the footprint that we have and where we are in relationship to where these storms grow and drop their hail cores and do all the damage.
We have more expensive cars, more expensive homes, and then just the frequency of our storms and the volatility of those storms are really adding up to just more claims and higher claim costs.
The clatter started to get stronger and louder, and more like rocks were being thrown at my window, and that's when I was just like, oh, this is a problem.
More people, more houses, more cars.
The back window's broken and the front window, the hail for the whole car.
And bigger shopping malls.
And then it was more, oh no, the whole mall's gonna collapse.
It all adds up to heftier price tags every time hailstones hit.
You know, we always cross our fingers as we head into hail season and say, maybe this isn't the year. Unfortunately, that's not what trends are telling us, the meteorologists are telling us, it's not what we're seeing when it comes to weather patterns, and unfortunately, that's just adding up to more claims, more expensive claims, and unfortunately, higher insurance premiums.
Which means May's billion-dollar storm won't be our last.
With the increasing size of civilization, there are going to be bigger ones, sure.
But at the same time, you know, Colorado is a wonderful place to live, and the hail storms are at least damage that we can recover.
Good thing for insurance.
And Denver certainly isn't getting any smaller. With an estimated 1,000 people moving to the metro every month, that is a lot more potential insurance claims next spring. when the storms hit.
Still ahead tonight, holes in the ceiling, stores flooded, merchandise ruined. We'll go inside the mall that was mangled by May's hailstorm. What construction crews had to do to rebuild Colorado Mills Mall after the billion-dollar storm.
Thanks for staying with us as we take a look inside Colorado's billion-dollar storm, the May blast of hail that damaged cars, destroyed businesses, and left this place, Colorado Mills Mall, shut down for the last 6 months. We just got a look inside the mall at the mammoth amount of work it took to reopen this place in time for the Christmas shopping season. The last time we saw inside Colorado Mills Mall was the evening of May 8th, when hail had blasted through the roof and punched holes through glass. It was raining inside stores.
It was devastating. I mean, you just don't have a concept of what it's like when water comes in all over everything. All of a sudden, you really look at it in daylight, and you go, this is bad. I mean, the hail didn't even melt till the next day, and it was still raining, and it's still raining inside the mall. And then you start to see what the damage really is.
The mall owner making the unprecedented decision to shut the entire place down.
This was massive. I mean, to have a mall taken out, and it's not by a tornado, and it's not by a hurricane, it's by a hailstorm. When has that really even happened?
Mother Nature delivering a devastating blow to hundreds who work here and to the city of Lakewood, which normally takes in about $350,000 a month in tax revenue from the mall.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm delighted to welcome you to the reopening of Colorado Mills.
3 days before Thanksgiving and just in time for the holiday shopping season, the state's largest outlet mall finally reopens.
We've been waiting for this day for over 6 months.
A newly restored look for the 1.1 million square foot mall. New signs, fresh paint, new drywall. The mall corridors, a maze of ladders and lifts, yellow vests and cleaning crews. Part of a Herculean round-the-clock effort to get stores making money again. Something everyone here is grateful for. This was the flooded out off-Broadway shoe store on the night of that hailstorm. Rain and hail destroying the store and its inventory. But this is that same store 6 months later, workers putting the finishing touches on installing the front windows ahead of the Thanksgiving week opening.
We'll have more stores reopening as the holiday season progresses.
Some bigger chain stores have hurried to reopen in recent weeks and months, like the Dick's Sporting Goods store back in September. But this shutdown has been devastating for small business owners who couldn't do the same. We talked to Pottery store owner Sandra Slonim back in May. She had liability and business insurance, meaning her employees kept getting paid until the mall reopened. But she knew not everyone did.
Thousands of people's day-to-day lives have been affected by this.
Other small business owners like Miley Medina, who owns Cataluma Chai, say opening day could not come soon enough.
If I'm being completely honest, about 8 o'clock last night, my staff and I, we were like little kids that were supposed to be cleaning their bedroom. And then you hear your mom coming up the stairs and you're shoving everything under your bed.
Even with a half year of hard work, not everything is back to normal. Some stores and restaurants still working to reopen, hoping to welcome customers sometime in the next month. In fact, look on the roof. Construction crews are still hard at work. On the ground, the same thing. There is still hail damage to repair.
And as you look around, you can see that we're a work in progress. We won't be completely finished until sometime into 2018. But it was really our focus to get people back to work as quickly as possible. So that's why we are so excited that it's happened this week. Finally, we're ready.
When it's all said and done, the dated 15-year-old outlet mall will look like this after several months and several million dollars in repairs, all because of our billion-dollar storm.
About 30 of the stores in the mall are locally owned, and when the place shut down 6 months ago, an estimated 2,000 to 3,000 people lost their jobs. But again, the good news tonight, many of them are finally back to work.
Coming up, 6 months later, they're still fixing their homes and their cars. The cleanup backlog, and when these neighbors might get back to normal after the billion-dollar storm.
Welcome back as we take a look at the recovery effort from Colorado's billion-dollar storm, that May 8th hailstorm that did $1.4 billion in damage, much of it to tens of thousands of vehicles like this one. This one's totaled. And if you haven't gotten your car fixed yet, hope you don't mind waiting till 2018 or even 2019. From the minute the hail started falling right here off Colfax in Golden, the folks right inside the door at Lawson's Paint and Body Shop knew they were in for it.
As soon as it subsided, we had cars pulling up here with busted windshields, shattered sunroofs, water going in cars, everything like that, and we realized immediately that we needed to get on board and address the situation probably as fast as possible.
That was 6 months ago. Business has not let up one bit since. Every pink circle you see here is damaged from a hailstone, and there have been tens of thousands of these pink circles.
Every single day we get more and more calls. We first thought that it was gonna subside or die off, but in fact it hasn't, and a lot of people are waiting, you know, thinking that this was all gonna pass, and then now they're gonna sneak in and they're realizing that it just keeps getting further and further out.
How far out? If your car isn't already fixed, hope you don't mind waiting another year or longer.
Right now we are booking for October 8th of 2018, and there's other places around town that are saying 2019 before they'll even get you in for hail.
The problem is the sheer volume. The hailstorm hit during rush hour, and those drivers who couldn't hide under overpasses had nowhere to go.
So you had so many cars just sitting ducks out there on the roadway. We heard from AAA that it was one of their first roadside assistance catastrophes because so many people were stranded on I-25.
Here we have a nice row of our GSs and ISs.
Auto dealers like Stevens and Lexus on the west side of town had their inventory pummeled. Insurance experts say another part of the issue is it is much more difficult, painstaking, and expensive to fix cars now than ever before.
Those windshields are more expensive to repair now because they have all the technology in them. And then we just had total lost cars. Cars that had to be completely replaced because that storm was so intense.
Oh yeah, we get them in about once a week. You know, we've got a few sitting out back right now that are totaled out.
Back at Lawson's, vehicles like this Jeep essentially had to be rebuilt.
This is the old roof here that we took off. Pretty much cut it right off the top, and then got a new one from Jeep that comes out. Kind of like a puzzle piece.
The average cost for a hail repair job from the May storm at this shop, anywhere from $16,000 to $20,000. A lot of money and a long wait. The only thing you'll need more than an insurance settlement after this storm is a whole lot of patience.
It still drives, you know. Be patient, we'll get to you as quick as we possibly can. We'll take great care of you when it's all said and done.
Best advice from those guys: if you find yourself in a huge hailstorm like May 8th, call or drive straight to a body shop. Get yourself to the front of the line so you don't wind up waiting a year or two for repairs.
We're not done yet. When we come back tonight, how to prepare, what you can do to get ready for the next billion-dollar storm.
Finally, tonight in our look back at Colorado's billion-dollar storm, a look forward to the next billion-dollar storm. And there is bound to be one since we live right here in Hail Alley. So as we leave you tonight, some advice from the insurance experts on how to prepare. Walk up close to this mobile home in Golden, you'll see the siding looks like Swiss cheese. 6 months later, and there is still so much damage in neighborhoods like this. So how do you keep this from happening to your house next year?
One of the main things you can do as a homeowner is invest in a hail-resistant roof.
There are now roofs made from recycled tires, rubber roofs, essentially hail-proof. It saves insurance companies a lot of money. Another tip, make sure you have plenty of coverage.
We just really want people to make sure they're financially prepared for living in Colorado. Make sure you're doing a financial checkup. You really need to get with your insurance professional and look at what your coverages are. So we say on an annual basis, really, know what your insurance covers, know what it doesn't cover, know what your car insurance covers. The comprehensive coverage on your vehicle, which is optional in Colorado, that's going to cover you for hail and also for flooding. So just make sure that you're financially prepared for really what we're up against in Colorado. So certainly just as a consumer, make sure you're smart, make sure you're financially prepared for living in Hail Alley.
Some tips from an expert on how to weather the next billion-dollar storm. Those same experts keeping their fingers crossed that what happened here in May doesn't happen again anytime soon. I'm Jeremy Hubbard. Thanks for joining us tonight.